a web developer at Required and a WordPress core developer with a strong passion for WordPress. Thank you for everything you do. Okay. He led the WordPress 4.6 release, is the technical leader of the Polyglot theme and lead developer of GlotPress, a collaborative web-based software translation tool. He also takes part in the WordPress.org meta and security teams to make translate.wordpress.org more awesome and WordPress more secure. Dominic is mostly known as Ocean 90. Okay, please.
Thank you. I think it's working.
It's working. Hello. Hi. Hi. Yeah. That's it. Okay. So yeah. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming. It's a bit early. Yeah, I know. So yeah. Thanks for joining my session in UK. And as mentioned before, I'm talking today about the topic about WordPress translation demystified. You probably don't know what it is, me neither, so I try to explain it, and I hope you are invited to the session, so we will have a good time now. To make the topic a little bit more clear, I have changed the topic a little bit more. To our change for today is to shed some light into the whole process of how WordPress handles translations. And that's mostly important because at the moment we are really that far that we have reached more than half of the user base which is not using American English as the language in WordPress. And to make this a little bit more interesting for today here in Tokyo, I checked the count statistics of the usage of the languages. And there you can see that Japanese is really the second most used language after American English, even before German with 5.4% and Spanish with 4.9%. So yeah, I wasn't always working for the translation part, and there was a guy called Andrew Nathan, you may know him. He was the guy who was really working before me on all the translation stuff. He has managed a lot of related stuff to internationalization, and at some point he thought about working for the White House, so there needed to be another guy who takes over his job. And yeah, that was me. So that all started in 2015, where I got this post from Andrew, where he, yeah, said that I can now take over the system. And yeah, that was pretty much my face at that moment, because you have to know, just like WordPress, the code on WordPress.org is also about 10 years or so old. It's not really stable, it's not really nice, it's not really object-oriented or what else. It's not really designed to have, at that point, to really support languages or language packs. That was something I took over, and over the last 2 or 3 years, I nearly rewrote all the parts of the translation code related to translate.wordpress.org, or even some core stuff like a language chooser, which we'll see later. Yeah. So, and yeah, that's mostly what my talk is now about, what I have done the last 3 years. And yeah. So, if you start with a new WordPress installation, you pretty much have something like this. You have a WordPress.zip file, and after unpacking, you will notice there are a lot of files with some English text, even the README or the index.php. And yeah, as I said, it's, everything is in English, but we actually want to have it in another language. So yeah, that's the English dashboard. But what is, if I want to have my site in another language, for example, in this language? Any idea which language it is? Sorry?
German.
Yeah, right, it's German. And so, any idea which language this is?
Italian.
Yes, right? You're good? Let's do another one. Any idea? Yeah, good. We have some really polyglots here. As you can see, this is also with right to left support, which is also supported by Core. And last but not least, I also have this language. Any idea?
Japanese.
Yes, right. So it's Japanese. So as you can see, we have a lot of languages. Actually, there are a few hundreds more. But let's take a look at the Swing dashboard. So you can see all the translations which are currently available for a dashboard. And as you can see, it's not just one translation. So now you can say, let's just translate all the word dashboard and include it in the WordPress core files. And so the initial WordPress.zip file would include all the translations. But it may work for just one string, but currently we have over 6,000 translatable strings. And yeah, that's a lot. And you have to know it's not just one language, we have over, I think, nearly 200 languages, so it's a lot. So what we really need is a way to maintain translation that first scales and also is accessible for translators, which are usually not developers. That's also always something you have to keep in mind when you work with translations, that the part which is actually the translation part is not done by developers, but instead by normal users who just want to have their dashboard in their native language. So, as you may know, WordPress is written in PHP, and there we have something called getText. And getText is a set of tools who allow us to make applications available in more than one language. For example, the main language might be English. With getText, we can make it available in much more languages. And in WordPress Core, we don't use the actual native getText library, but we have a few functions which are a custom prepper for a custom library called POMO. Po and Mo are two file types, and I will say a little bit more on that later. In this example, you can see we have the underscore underscore function, which just includes the first argument dashboard, which is the English string. And the idea of this getText function is that it just registers the string dashboard, and the result or the return value of the dashboard should be the translation of dashboard in your current language. There are a few other getText functions which I will mention because they are a little bit more important for the translations part. For example, context matters. That's really an important part in WordPress because, as you can see, we have the string about, which is in English the same for all the three contexts. So the second argument in this case is page title or theme starter content, which is the argument for the context. And that's important because some languages have different translations based on the context. Even in Japanese, we have two different translations. For example, the first one is about, which is used on the WordPress About page. So the translation includes WordPress, which is fine, but it's probably not fine for the other two cases. In this case, it's just the probably the translation of About. And besides the context, we also can define comments, which are also useful for translators. As you have heard, they are not usually developers, so they probably don't know what the person S means. In this case, you can add a simple translator's comment to explain what the string is about. For example, in this case, it's the user dashboard screen title. And you can explain the placeholder. In this case, it's the network name. Now we have the translations or the strings in core, but we still don't have them in a way how we can translate them. There's a tool called MakePod. MakePod is a custom tool by WordPress, which extracts the translatable strings from core plugin, core plugin or C files. It's a custom because WordPress also use the special syntax for the translators commas, as we have seen before. And we also have in theme and plugins a custom header, for example, for the theme description or plugin name, which are also extracted by the MakePod script. And there's an important part about this MakePod script which you have to know as a developer, that during this process the files are only parsed and not executed, which means we shouldn't, for example, use any constants for the text domain part. So as mentioned, MakePod is a custom CLI tool for PHP, which creates pod files for the core files, plugin themes, and also for some of our web.org projects, like the localized Rosetta sites. It's open source, of course. You can find it at this URL. And it's kind of similar to PoEdit, which is a GUI tool for, I think, for Windows and Mac and so on. But in this case, our script also supports the custom header fields. So how does a pod file look like, or what does it even mean? So pod stands for Portable Object Template. So this is basically the file which you get with the MakePod file. It first contains the reference, which is, starts with the hashtag and the file path and the line number. And it also has the string cross dashboard as the ID. And the translation is actually empty. So message string is in this case empty because it's a template file which is used for creating the actual language files. Here's another example which also includes a singular and plural version. For example, the first one is the singular version and the second one the plural version. And depending on the language or the local, we have different translations for the singular and plural version. And of course, the pod file also includes translator comments, which are helpful for the translators. And we also have the context in this case, the message context personal data group label. This MakePod script is run by CronJob, and is, who doesn't know what the CronJob is? So it's basically a time-based job scheduler where you can define a specific task which should run at a specific time. And that's what we are using also on webs.org. So this MakePod commands are used in a custom web file which is called generate minus pod dot sh, and it also updates the SVN checkout and finally commits the pod files to our SVN repository. So now we have the pod file. What would be the next part? Why? How can we translate the pod file? There are a few tools, like as mentioned before, PoEdit, but there's also a web-based tool called TransiFX, which you can use. But today I'm going to talk about a tool called GlobQuest. As mentioned in the introduction, it's a web-based software translation tool, which we also use for translating, or which you can use for translating pod files. GlobQuest was, the initial commit of GlobQuest was done 9 years ago by Nikolai, and it's an official sister project just like BBPress or BuddyPress. There was a time where GlobQuest was using the WordPress library, Backwards Library was a project with the goal to have all the WebS Core files as a library, to say, which you can use in another project. But because there wasn't really a maintainer, or we didn't want to have the same work twice, because WebS Core and Backwards, this project got abandoned. And even after BBPress and BuddyPress also removed the BuddyPress dependency, it was time to let CloudPress also follow this step. And this step was done 2 years ago. And since that, we also had over 20 releases as a WordPress plugin. Everyone who wants to have a CloudPress installed can just install the WordPress plugin and have their own CloudPress installed, which is far easier than before. And yeah, we actually have over 35 contributors, which are led by Craig Voss and me. So now, of course, everyone can install their own CloudPress install, but that wouldn't be really a good idea, because yeah, how do we get all the status into your own CloudPress install? So what we have is translate.webs.org. It's a huge install of CloudPress on the webs.org servers, which is maintained by the Meta team. And it's really used to give translated a central platform to provide translations in a really simple way. The only thing you need is a webs.org account. And after that, you can submit translations and either you are already in editor or not. In case of not, your translations will get reviewed by an editor who will approve the translation. And it's not only used for Core. You can also translate themes, plugins, some of the meta projects, or even the mobile apps. Everything on translate.webs.org, you only have to have a webs.org account. So we have our pod files and we have translate.webs.org. Now it's time to import the pod files, which is also done in the background. It also runs on the cron job every hour. It uses the CloudPress default CLI importer. And if you are on the webs.org Slack, you also get some notifications in case of new translations for Core or Meta projects. Now that the pod file is imported, a translator will see something like this. For example, we have our dashboard screen again. That's how the current editor for translators looks like. You will see them. Yep. Okay, let's go. So we have the dashboard screen, and in this case, this is a translation which is provided by the. Okay. Can you hear me? Yes. Oh, okay. Perfect. So we have the dashboard swing, and this one is translation which is provided by the translators. You can also add another translation in case this one was false. And I mentioned before in the pod files, we also have the references to the files, which you can see here to get a little bit more context of the initial dashboard swing, for example. You also can, depending on your role, to reject or set the status to fuzzy, which it's usually used for automatic translations. Yeah. So now that we have the translations, we still don't have them in your local WordPress install. So we finally have to think about how can we send the translation back to WordPress. In this case, we do it in so-called language packs, which is just an export of translations in a zip file, which is updated every 12 to 24 hours, and it usually includes 8 files, or 6 to 8 files, and which is done because of performance reasons. For example, wadmin or wp-admin and the front end have together 4,000 strings, and each has 2,000 strings. So if you load the front end, we don't need the admin strings. So in this case, we have split the translations up into 6 to 8 files. 6 to 8 because we also have locals for American English, for British English or Australian English, which are actually using the same city names or the same translation for the city names as American English. So in this case, they only have 6 files, which is also the continent cities file. Now back to the POMO library. As said before, it's 2 file types, which is PO, which is a portable object, which is just a textual edited file with a header and translations. As you can see, we again have our dashboard string. In this case, the message string part is filled with translation, not empty anymore. And it also includes a date, the revision date, the 5th line, which is used to update them. For example, if you provide a new translation, you also need a way to know which version we have installed and which we can update. And the other one is, so this PO file is only really used for the date actually. And WordPress itself uses a file which is called MO or machine object. It only contains the translations in bytecode, so it's just the same as before, only a bytecode. And this is actually used by the getText function. So now we have the language packs, but still don't have them sent to WordPress itself back. For this, we have something called Web Translation API, which is a function in core with 2 arguments. The first one is for the type. You either want to update plugins, themes, or core languages, or you want to get translations for core, plugins, or themes. And those two are similar to themes API or plugins API, which are just communicating with api.wordpress.org. So since we still want to have the translation for dashboard, we would have to provide type with core. And as a version, we can, for example, pass 4.7.4. And the response would look like this. And there you can also see our language pack at the package key. So it's a pretty simple API which just returns all the available language packs and their translation. Now we have the API, and now we can get back to the initial WordPress installation, which should look like this if you are using WordPress, at least WordPress 4.0, which finally introduced this language chooser on the install, which in the background loads the translation files or the language packs. And it's also the main reason why you don't find any translations anymore in the WordPress.zip file, in the initial WordPress.zip file which you are loading for on WordPress.org. And there's also a fun feature, I think, depending on the language, it also updates the continue button, the label on the continue button. So it's really awesome. Yeah. And yeah, really, WordPress loves language packs because of this reason to make it so easy to select another language than American English. Those language packs are stored in the WP content language directory, which also makes it possible to share them across a site. If you have, for example, a multi-site, there's just one language directory, and you can install as many languages as you want. The language files are also updated automatically. You don't have to press any buttons or, I don't know, load them via FTP or so. And it really shouldn't take longer than 24 hours to get new translations, because we have a super easy process to update them, which also includes the work by the translators and the editors. And with the help of language packs, you also can easily switch the language after. For example, if you started with English and now you want to have your site in Japanese, you just can go to the settings page, select another language, and in the background, without the language pack, and activate the language. And that's all you have to do. This also includes the translations for plugins and themes, which are also updated during other updates. And because I know some people don't like really auto updates so far, this is probably even one more reason why you shouldn't disable them, because otherwise you wouldn't get all the fancy stuff provided by the language packs. Now we have the language files on the server. Now we have to load them. In this case, we have the core translation API. For core, we have, for example, the load default text domain function, which simply loads the language file on the server depending on the context, for example, front end, WP admin, or network admin. And with the help of this function, we are finally back to our getText function, which is underscore with the dashboard string. And now it should return the translation of the string dashboard in your selected language. So this was an example for core. So the question might be, are language packs also a thing for plugins and themes? And the answer is, of course, yes. And they work more or less like cores. It basically means that we started in December 2015, where we also allowed to have plugins and theme authors use. Where we allowed plugin and theme authors to use our translation platform, which means those authors don't have to update or create any pod files anymore, or you don't have to ship translation files by translators which may contain any spam or other strings which without your knowledge, because you don't know the language actually. And you don't have to do an update for 6 actually. So the only thing we really have to do is just define the request at least 4.6. Then you don't have to define the text domain or load plugin text domain, because WebS Core is so clever that it all does this task for you. Yes, of course, the plugin and the theme must be hosted in the official WordPress directory, and that's all you have to do to make them, to make language packs ready for your, to make plugin and themes ready for your language packs. If you want to know more about them, we have a handbook page where we have some more information on this. Some good to know things. If you have your plugin or theme author for the first time importing into translate.webs.org, you have a custom or its own language, our Slack channel called Meta Language Packs, which has some helpful information. For example, the first one was okay, and the second one has some issues. In this case, it was the wrong text domain in the header, so the plugin auto now knows what they have to fix. Language packs for plugin and themes are updated every, or updated 30 minutes after a change, and they are usually generated when the project is at least 95% or more translated. And there's also a special page on your project page on translate.webs.org where you can see the current language packs. So there's a drop-down menu where you can select language packs, and then you can get an overview about all the available language packs. So you may have noticed that I have mentioned contrast a few times today, and it's probably one of the most important part of the whole system, because without contrast, we all had to do the task manually, which was done, I don't know, 5 years ago or so. And since we now wanted to support plugins and themes, we really had to find a long-term solution for this. And since we are already using WordPress for the plugin directory, or now also CloudPress, which is a WordPress plugin, why not using WordPress for this? And luckily, WordPress has its own Cron API with the function WP schedule single event, which we could use. But there's one thing you have to know about WP Cron. It's not really a Cron system like you know, because it's kind of a pseudo-Cron system, because every time a user visits your site, it makes a ping to your, or the site makes a ping to itself to get the actual jobs run. So if you don't have any users, you don't have any jobs executed. And that's not really a good idea for using this for our language packs and so on. But in this case, we are just using another WordPress plugin, which is called Cavalcade. And Cavalcade is a drop-in replacement for WP Cron, developed by HumanMade. It basically looks like this. We have our WordPress with the default WP Cron API functions. We have a custom table called WP Cavalcade Jobs, which includes all the jobs to, I don't know, to import plugins, import themes, or update translations, update language packs. And it was really easy to integrate this setup into WordPress.org, because we don't really need any code changes. We just had to install the plugin, the drop-in replacement, and a custom runner, which runs now on each server and has, I think, 4 default workers, which can now run all the Cron jobs. Some of the features are that we have the guaranteed running, so we don't have the loopback HTTP call anymore. It's really run by a custom worker on the server. It's also designed for multi-site, which we are heavily using on WordPress.org. It's scalable because you can run the worker or the runner on each server. For example, if you have just one server, you have one worker with, or one runner with 4 workers, or if you have like 10 servers, you can run the runner with each, can have each 4 workers, so you can have as much runners of the cavalcade to execute more cron jobs at the same time. Same time is the next point, parallel processing. You can run, depending on the actual workers, for example, if you have just one server, you can run 4 tasks at the same time. And because the cron jobs are all stored in a database table, you also have some kind of status monitoring, which you don't have for the default cron API. As I said before, it's a WebS plugin. You only have to install the WebS plugin, define or disable the default WP Cron API, and you also have some WP CLI commands to run commands in case of errors. And the second part is the one which you install on your server which reads the jobs from the database table and runs each command. And that's something we have now running since WebCamp Europe, I think it's 2016 or 2017. And during this time, it already has processed over 70 million tasks, which is only really possible with the help of Cavalcade and all the setup we now have. So, I really often get asked about some statistics about the translation platform. So, today I want to share some of them. At the moment, we have over 180 locals, which means the drop-down menu, or for example, the language chooser on the install could display 180 locals, but there are only a few, I think about 50 at the moment, who are really fully translated. But it's possible to translate in 180 locals. We have the special role editors, which is used to review provide translations. We actually have over 20,800 editors, which can control the provided translations by 41,000 translators. And those translators can actually translate over 100 projects, which includes core, all the versions down to 4.0, I think, or 4.1, and also the plugins and themes and mobile apps and all our WebS.org projects. Which means we have a lot of translations. Here you can see a little graph, for example, in 2010, we just had, in this year, over 700,000 translations. But in 2015, where we started importing plugins and themes, in just in this year, we added 21 billion translations just for plugins and themes. And today we had over 54 million current translations. And these translations are also provided with the language packs. So each plugin and theme and core has its own language packs. And we have actually over 100,000 active language packs, which are shipped from the API to any web installation. Which means we have a lot of downloads of these language packs, which is probably now a little bit more over 3.5 billion downloads. Now I'm coming to the end, but before that I want to talk a little bit about the future of each section which I have talked about today. The first one is CloudPress. We have some ideas for CloudPress. The first one was to have cross-service for locals and also JavaScript localization. That's something we have done last year. Some of the other topics are to have comments or notes on translations, but also to have a way to reject translations with feedback. There's also an idea to improve the API, to use the WordPress infrastructure of the REST API, to improve the templating, the design, but also thinking about introducing translation memory, which is a way to provide translations similar to ProEdit, which means we use all our translations which we currently have to help translators much faster provide translations, or also consistent translations. For language packs, we want to have faster updates for core. As mentioned before, they are currently only updated every 12 to 24 hours. And for blocks and themes, we have the 30 minutes part. So we really want to have them also faster. And we want to reduce the number of complex packages. In this case, for example, Japanese is also one of this. You may know the WP multibyte patch, which is something we have talked about yesterday on the contributor day. And yeah, we want to have the release bit also more automatic, which means move the README HTML to translator server support and to stop the requirement to have SVN for some files. And we also want to switch to some commands more to the WP CLI ecosystem. There's a talk at 2 p.m. from Pascal. So if you want to know more on this part, I really recommend to go into his talk. And also some ideas for core, of course. We want to have some performance improvements because getText is really one of the functions which is probably used the most in core, even for American English. And the idea is, for example, to use the native getText library in PHP. And also, we have to find a good way to provide JavaScript localization. In this case, we have to take a look at Gutenberg because it's a JavaScript application and there's currently no... Well, I mean, there is an API, but not something I would like to see provided in core. So we really have to work on this part. And if you're really interested in one of these parts, like WordPress or core, you can get in contact with me. I'm happy to provide any help, because I know it's probably one of the complex topics involved, because it affects so many parts of WordPress itself. Yeah, and that was my talk.